वेलकम बैक। सो टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू स्टार्ट विथ ट्रांसफार्मर्स। आई हैव स्टिल नॉट डन एसी सर्किट्स, एक्चुअली सिंगल फेज एसी सर्किट्स, फेजर रिप्रेजेंटेशन, विच आई प्लान टू डू वेरी सून, बट आई थॉट इट्स अ बिट ऑफ अ ब्रेव आइडिया, बट वर्थ इट। बेसिकली ट्रांसफार्मर इज जस्ट इन अ वे लुक स्ट्रांगली मैग्नेटिकली कपल्ड सेट ऑफ कॉइल्स, सो वी कैन डेवलप सम ऑफ द बेसिक आइडियाज ऑफ द ट्रांसफार्मर स्ट्रेट अवे, एंड देन लेटर ऑन वंस आई हैव डन द एसी सर्किट्स, द सिंगल फेज एसी सर्किट्स, देन वी विल रिविजिट इट एट दैट पॉइंट ऑफ टाइम अगेन। सो दिस हियर इज अ बेसिक जनरल डायग्राम ऑफ ट्रांसफार्मर एज यू वुड सी, अ फेराइट कोर और आयरन कोर, यूजली लैमिनेटेड टू कट कट द एडी करंट लॉसेस। सो इट ऑन द देर आर टू कॉइल्स, प्राइमरी एंड सेकेंडरी, दे आर ऑल्सो कॉल्ड वाइंडिंग्स, N1 टर्न्स एंड N2 टर्न्स। इफ द करंट वॉज मूव गोइंग इन द डायरेक्शन I1 एज शोन हियर, देन वॉट यू वुड सी इज द फ्लक्स विल बी जनरेटेड इन द डायरेक्शन ∅1। नाउ जस्ट इफ आई एक्सपेरिमेंटली पुट अ करंट इन टू दिस आई टू कॉइल, देन अगेन यू कैन चेक इट यूर सेल्फ दैट फ्लक्स विल बी इन द सेम डायरेक्शन, ∅2 इज ऑल्सो इन द सेम डायरेक्शन। सो बिकॉज दी एम एम एफ्स हैव एडिटिव नेचर हियर, दे क्रिएट फ्लक्स इन द सेम डायरेक्शन इन दिस कॉमन मैग्नेटिक पाथ। सो देयर फोर इफ वी प्लेस वन डॉट हियर एंटर विथ करंट एंटरिंग हियर, एंड देन इफ आई हैव शोन अ करंट एंटरिंग हियर एंड इट इज क्रिएटिंग अ एडिटिव फ्लक्स, देन आई शुड बी प्लेसिंग द डॉट हियर ओनली एंड नॉट एट दिस पॉइंट। सो फर्स्ट थिंग इज दैट आई पुट दिस डॉटेड कन्वेंशन। वंस आई हैव पुट अ डॉट, देन माई जॉब इज सिंप्लीफाइड, देन एक्चुअली आई डोंट नीड टू शो ऑल दिस कोर एंड एवरीथिंग। सो आई कैन एक्चुअली जस्ट शो इट एज टू कपल्ड कॉइल्स, द वाइंडिंग्स, द वे इट इज वाउंड इज नॉट रिक्वायर्ड, बिकॉज द डॉट्स एसेंशियली टेल यू दैट इफ करंट इज एंटरिंग दिस डॉटेड टर्मिनल एज वेल एज दिस डॉटेड टर्मिनल, देन इन द कॉमन मैग्नेटिक पाथ द फ्लक्स नेचर वुड बी एडिटिव, दैट इज द एम एम एफ टेंड टू एड अप एंड इंक्रीज द फ्लक्स इन दिस पर्टिकुलर डायरेक्शन। That's the thing. Now, in transformers, basically, I have to said this earlier also. Basically, either step up or step down voltages can't be used with DC circuits. Obviously, cannot be used with DC circuits. And the idea is that if V1 is the voltage applied to the first coil. So the V1 should not be DC, otherwise d∅ by dt will go to zero. Then the voltage induced will be given by this equation on the primary side and V2 d∅ by dt on the secondary side, for the time on the secondary side. So if you take V1 by V2, it is N1 by N2. But so with when you connect a sinusoidal AC source on the primary and a load on the secondary, load means a resistance, a combination of RLC, for example, circuit on the secondary, then you will be in a position to apply this. Even if you say, for example, a 1:1 transformer, just take one simple example, and let's say 100 turns on first side. Okay, 100:1 transformer. And one turn on the second side. So this usually will be called as a step down transformer. First, what we write on the left hand side is primary, and then what we write on the in the ratio afterwards is secondary. So the primary is where primary is where we connect the source, and sink is where we connect the load. So what happens here is that primary voltage will be 100 times more. So V1 by V2, this is instant by instant. Instant by instant, V1 by V2 will be 100 by 100 times of V2. So therefore, what happens is, it's like if you are connecting source on the primary, a voltage source on the primary, you are stepping it down and then connecting it to the load. This you see routinely, you know, for example, we have this 220 volt supply, we use electronics which is at like 10 volt level or whatever. So we have to step down the voltage and then rectify it and feed it. Or any other place, many applications, most because I have already told you earlier that it's better to transmit electricity at comparatively higher voltage because then the losses in the wires are less, and then consume it at a lower voltage, which is more convenient. So there will be, therefore, with AC circuits, there will always be a step down transformer which will come into play. It's a non-rotating device. Even though treated as a machine, it is actually a non-rotating device. So it's not actually a machine in that sense. It is only faithfully scaling, reproducing primary and secondary sides, scaling up or scaling down without doing any conversion of energy from like a motor will do electrical to mechanical, or a generator may have a mechanical to electrical conversion. Like that, it's not here. It's just electrical to electrical only. But this V1 by V2 will follow this law of N1 by N2. Now, you know this is a coupled coil representation. You have understood the importance of putting these dots. You should be very careful about it. Usually with transformers, the current is shown to come out from the dotted terminal. The reason is, it's not like there is a source connected here which pushes current in this direction, and there is a source connected here which pushes current in this direction. This is not the normal way we use transformer. There is a source which is connected on this side, but a load connected here draws that current I2. So therefore, the convention is to show current entering on in one dotted terminal and current leaving the other dotted terminal. Even if you show both of them entering, there is no problem. But that's not incorrect, but this is the convention. Now, if the current is N1 I1 is the MMF set up by the primary. Okay, let me directly draw the circuit here. So let's say that this is the N1 I1. This is your reluctance R. This is the flux in the core, and just a minute. This is N2 I2. This is the N2 I2. So now, the point is, if I follow the convention which is here, then because the two fluxes are additive, they tend to create flux in the same direction. I will put plus and minus like this to indicate that the two fluxes are additive. But if I have shown the current I2 as good, if I have shown the current I2 as leaving this terminal, then actually the flux that is MMF that it is going to create is going to be subtractive in nature. With this positive current, the MMF that it is going to create is subtractive in nature, and hence I can write that N1 I1, I'm sorry, N1 I1 minus N2 I2 is equal to phi times of R. And what is reluctance? Reluctance is 1 by mu 0 mu R L by A. A is the area of the cross section of the core, and L is the average length of the complete path of a flux line, average path line. Now, if we take a ideal core, then mu r can be taken to approach infinity. I mean, like it would be 10,000 or 1,000,000 or something like that. So it approaches infinity. So what happens to the reluctance of the path? It becomes zero, and therefore, the right hand side becoming zero, you get N1 I1 is equal to N2 I2. That is the net MMF acting on the circuit becomes zero. So this is also called as the MMF balance principle. Instant by instant, N1 I1 will be equal to N2 I2. So therefore, I1 by I2 will be equal to N2 by N1. So here the voltage is scaled in proportion to the number of turns. Here the current scale in inverse proportion to the number of turns. Now if you multiply this equation and this equation, what do you get? You will get V1 I1 by V2 I2 is equal to N1 by N2 into N2 by N1, which is 1, which means instant by instant you will get power match. That means the instantaneous power, which is electrical power, which is entering the circuit from the primary side, the same instantaneous power will be leaving on the secondary side. So therefore, this is like a constant power kind of a device. It doesn't like you must have heard about amplifiers in electronic circuits and so on and so forth, where you want to do amplification of power or this thing. There is no amplification concept here. Only the level of the voltages and currents are scaled up and down as per your requirement, but the power which goes into the primary, the same power comes out of the secondary. And this device here is also called as a two-winding transformer because there are only two windings on it. You could have one primary and two secondary windings also feeding two different. So in that case, you will have one primary, one secondary, and one tertiary winding. The tertiary winding could be connected to some third load also. So then that would be a single, this is a single phase two winding transformer. That would be a single phase three winding transformer. And subsequently, we will also be discussing three phase transformers, but that's a story which will come much later. Now, I want to give you another perspective on this, which is coming from the BH curve of the of this circuit. So imagine now, I said no, like reluctance you take mu r tending to infinity, reluctance becomes zero. That was a very algebraic kind of a way of expression. But here what I have shown is B is equal to mu 0 mu r h. For the time being, hysteresis and other hysteresis effect has been ignored. Now if let's say this is the line which represents mu r equal to 1, b equal to mu 0 h, where mu 0 is what? 4 pi into 10 to the power minus 7. Then this is mu r equal to 1000 line, this line. So what do you see? The slope has increased. When you make mu r equal to 10,000, the slope is much more, even much more higher. The angle may be like 85 degrees in this case. So when you take mu r tending to infinity, or you make mu r infinity, what is going to happen? The slope will become, BH curve will become just this vertical y-axis line, or the B line, or the y-axis line. So I have shown it here. Now, what does this indicate? It indicates that to create any B, means in this ideal material, to create any B here or here, doesn't matter, to create any B in this magnetic circuit, what is the H that is required? The H required on this whole line is 0. So therefore, what happens to H into L? What happens to H into L? It becomes 0. So you could also explain this as n1 i1 minus n2 i2 is equal to H into L, which for ideal circuit is will be 0, and therefore n1 i1 is equal to n2 i2. So you could explain it through the concept of reluctance. You could directly explain it from this thing. This is an idealization. In reality, will it ever happen that mu r will be infinity? No. So therefore, some H will be required. And when you say some H is required, then some current will also be drawn by the coil, primary coil, even if you keep the secondary open circuited, to just set up the flux in the core. Okay. Now, let's talk of equivalent circuit for this transformer. In the machines course, this kind of power engineering course or a machines course, we discuss a device, the physics of the device, the operation of the design, and then usually draw a equivalent circuit for the same. So I have already given you basic equivalent circuit of a ideal transformer. This is the just a representation. It doesn't require any more circuitry. This is the basic representation of an ideal transformer. Now, when I say, okay, if V equal to d phi by dt is a basic general equation in d phi by dt, and if V is Vm sin omega t, because we will be dealing with differential circuits, so then you can see that phi should be in steady state, would be of the nature of phi m cos of omega t, or I will put it the other way, like wrong, put it much more simpler so that you don't need to do the integration. Suppose that phi is given by in the flux in the core is given by phi m sin of omega t, then the d phi by dt of it will be phi m omega cos of omega t, and so the v will become v n phi m omega cos of omega t. So in our case of transformer primary, it would look like this, and for the secondary, it will be again a scaled sinusoidal or cosinusoidal waveform of this product. Now, what is the difference between a sinusoid and a cosinusoid? This is a sinusoid. Suppose instead that I draw t equal to 0 axis somewhere here, at the peak somewhere here. Earlier t equal to 0 is shifted here. Earlier I had put, this is a waveform which is going ad infinitum on the left side and on the right side both. So, and this is my t axis, this is any quantity x. So if I put it here, t equal to 0 is here, I call it sin omega t or sin of omega t. Same thing, just if I had t equal to 0, then this waveform would be called as cos omega t. And if I had just t equal to 0 axis somewhere here, t equal to 0 axis somewhere here, then this waveform would be written as sine of, let's say the amplitude is 1 so that I don't have to scale by the amplitude, then this will be written as sine of omega t plus of phi. So the point which I am trying to sort of make is that a waveform like this can be just called a sinusoid. A cosinusoid and a sinusoid are basically just the same waveforms, but only thing that change, the shift of the zero crossing, is with respect to where the t is equal to 0 happens. When I have two such waveforms, I have to be very careful because the waveforms may not be crossing zeros at the same time. So wherever I put t equal to 0, the phase difference will remain constant, and it is usually that which is more important. So now in this, coming back to what I was saying, that the V1 and V2 V2 would be sinusoids like this. So the point that I am trying to make is, see, this device is not this device is in some sense a bilateral device. So if you connect if you had a sinusoidal flux linkage in the core, the voltages on the primary and the secondary will be cosinusoids. Conversely, if you had cosinusoidal primary voltage, just say you had a cosinusoidal primary voltage, then from this equation, that means if you had V1 of t to be equal to Vm cos of omega of t, then you could immediately calculate the flux will in steady state have a waveform which is phi m sine of omega t, and the phi m can be calculated by equating this to Vm, the Vm here. So you would get n phi m omega to be equal to Vm, or you will get phi m to be equal to Vm by omega n. And once that is done, then this waveform is properly described. Once you know that the flux is a sinusoidal waveform, so the point what I am trying to say is that sinusoidal voltages when connected to transformer primary would create sinusoidal flux, phase shift phase shift of 90 degree, because a sinusoid So this is a sine wave, and this here is a cosine wave, and then you carry forward. So the zero crossing of the peak of the cosine wave with the similar peak of sine wave, if this is theta, then this is pi by 2, this is pi. So it leads the cosine wave peak of, and every other value also, peak of cosine wave leads, so Suppose the waveform was going like this. So I would say that rising peak of cosine wave leads rising peak of sine wave by 90 degree. So the phase lead, the term used here is the phase lead in the cosine wave is 90 degrees with respect to the sine wave, which usually in our trigonometric identity also we write that c theta n plus 90 degrees is equal to cos of theta. So this is your phase lead, which is sitting here. So now let me add one more page here. So the point that I am trying to sort of say now here is that this is the let's say this is the flux waveform with time. So because it's a flux waveform, a scaled version of it is going to be the B waveform also with time, and B is equal to mu 0 mu r h. So if I just give me a second. If I draw a BH curve, let me for the sake of simplicity draw it at 45 degrees. That's not a right thing to do, but just for my sake of drawing, other scale factors will only change. Other than that, nothing else is going to change. So now let's say this is B versus flux versus time, or B versus time in the transformer core. Then this is B and H. So therefore, the H, and instead of H, what is H? H is Ni by L. So I becomes H times L by N, which means that the current in the winding, for the time being, just imagine that the secondary winding is open circuited. There is only one winding, which is the primary, which is connected to a source. Then the current which will be flowing through it is going to be just a scaled version of H. Just like B is a scaled version of phi or lambda, similarly, I is just a scaled version of H. So instead of this, I could as well write B versus I here. The magnetizing current, this is to set up the flux in the core, what we are doing. So where does zero maps to zero, and the I of t is also going to be here. Now in this circuit, this side here also I am taking this to be also T. So don't worry about it. It is also T only. So upside is B, downside is T. Okay. Now let's see the current, how the current will look like, magnetizing current. Now let's say that the B increases to this value. At this T, the B increases to this value. So the current here will come the current, it will take this value of current, and same amount of offset of t. This is 0.1. This is also going to be my 0.1. Maybe I'll just use this one only. Now let's take another point here, at the second point somewhere here. Then at this B, the corresponding H will be taken by projecting the mirror image on the H axis. So this becomes the corresponding value of the X H. And then if this was T1, this is T2, this is T1, And so somewhere I'll just draw it. Please don't mind. My scale may have changed a bit. I'll get T2 here, and then you will get the peak coming here at 90 degrees P or theta. So 90 degrees, you will get the third point coming here. And then if you project this idea, think this idea through, what do you see? You will see that this becomes the waveform of the current. So the if the point what I am trying to say, the point which I am trying to say is that the point that I am trying to say is that if phi is sinusoidal, so is I the magnetizing current. It being in phase with phi, and with respect to voltage, what is the relationship between this and circuit representation between current and voltage? V equal to N d phi by dt in terms of circuit when you talk of magnetizing current should be modeled as an inductor that with V equal to L di by dt. So that is, I think, obvious. I don't have to make any further statement on that. So if now I want to address non-ideality, see the mu r is very high, so the magnetizing current is going to be extremely low, 1%, 2% usually in power transformers. Power transformers means transformers which are used to handle megawatts and MVAs. So then that magnetizing current need not be put directly into, we can continue to retain the notion of ideal transformer. And this small aberration, let us show by a inductive element XM connected in shunt with this ideal transformer. Why do I connect it in shunt? I connect it in shunt because when I connect a voltage source here on the primary side, then ideal transformer will not draw any current because N1 I1 has to be equal to N2 I2. Since the I2 is 0, the I1 has to be also equal to 0. But we know that a magnetizing current like this has to flow. So where will the magnetizing current flow? The magnetizing current will flow in this. Therefore, a shunt branch is only required because if I put it in series, then it would flow in the primary winding. But I don't want to flow it in the primary winding. Primary winding is carrying I1. So I have to connect a shunt branch of XM for the magnetizing current IM to flow in it. All right. Next thing that I want to take up now is, one by one, I am basically adding non-idealities to this. I have already mentioned to you that in a circuit like this, when you set up a flux, there will be some leakage which will take place, which goes in this particular way. And if the current actually is flowing out of, if it is flowing in, then the leakage is going to be like this, but if it is flowing out, then leakage flux would be set up in the other way round. The leakage flux would be, here it is like this. Here the leakage flux is like this, but if this, I'm sorry, if the current was flowing out, then the leakage flux would be like this. So anyway, the point is there is going to be leakage flux, and when I connect loads to the primary and secondary, I connect it with a load that is close the circuit on the secondary side and connect primary to the source, then a primary current will flow, a secondary current will flow, N1I1 will be equal to N2I2. If this is a simple resistor here, if it is a simple resistor here, then V2 would be simply, or rather I2 will, V2 we know, V2 is scaled replica of V1. So V2 is simply N2 by N1 times of V1. And suppose I had connected a resistance R here, then I2 would be simply V2 by R, and therefore a current I1 will also be set up on the primary side, and this will explain your circuit. If the voltage is sinusoid, the current is also going to be sinusoid. I1 and I2 are also going to be sinusoid. Now suppose higher is the current, then higher is the corresponding Ni that it creates. Of course it balances out. Of course it is cancelled out. It is cancelled out by this principle N1 I1 equal to N2 I2. But still the currents are flowing and they are setting up the flux. And what you see in the core is a consequence of cancellation effect. But as far as leakage flux is there, the leakage flux will be set up. And bigger the current, more will be the leakage flux which will come out of it. So therefore, the leakage flux increases in proportion to the primary current and the secondary current winding currents. So therefore, we would prefer to show the leakage flux here as leakage L1. Let's call this as LM, inductances by L, and the secondary leakage inductance by L2. Why I have placed this, not placed here, but placed it somewhere here? Because even the magnetizing current is going to set up a leakage flux. Not even if secondary is open circuited and primary is connected to a voltage source, then a magnetizing current, as I explained to you just here, due to the finite mu r value, is going to flow, and when it flows, some part of it, not all of it will come and link here, but some fraction of it will sort of leak through. So therefore the point that I am trying to tell you is that the leakage inductance will play a role for both open circuit as well as loaded circuit. Hence, L1 has to come here and not here. Once current flows in secondary, then the leakage is associated with that winding also. So therefore, L2 has to be connected on this side. Finally, both the circuits have resistances, and it is clear that these resistances should also come in series. Is it not? Why should they come in series? Because higher is the current in the primary winding, higher is the drop across its resistance, and higher will be the I square R loss which is associated with it. Same is with the secondary also. So when the complete current has to flow through this element, then it should be connected in series. If the complete voltage has to be applied to it, then it should be connected in shunt. That's the basic principle. So I connect R1 and R2 obviously in series here. Now one last thing that I have missed out when I am specifically talking of AC circuits dealing with sinusoids. If the flux is taking a sinusoidal waveform, If the flux is taking a sinusoidal waveform, then it is always returning, going to positive peak value, then decreasing to zero, then going to negative peak value, then increasing to zero, then again going to positive peak value. So on the BH curve, this is a bad figure, but it's okay. The BH curve will show a hysteresis loop like this. BH curve will show a hysteresis loop like this. Smaller the voltage applied, smaller is the hysteresis. Bigger is the voltage applied, higher is the area enclosed in the hysteresis. So more are the hysteresis losses. And something similar you can say about the eddy current losses also. So both the hysteresis and eddy, and because of this BH curve, I will leave it to you to think about. But this current will no more look like a sinusoid. It will have a variation from sinusoid, though it will still be a periodic waveform, but it will look different from a sinusoid. So I leave it to you to ponder on that point, that how it will look. Now, if I want to show the hysteresis empirically, I can show a shunt branch in parallel with RM with respect to LM, and now this completes my equivalent circuit of a transformer. This is some RLC combination, which I call it as load, which is a usually some kind of a RLC combination. Now, why have I shown RM here? Why have I shown RM here as parallel to LM? First of all, RM should not come in series, because this hysteresis loss only depends upon voltage applied and does not depend upon what is the current drawn by this load. For example, if a one resistance load was drawing, would draw, let's say, approximately 10 amperes, then a 10 ohm resistor would effectively just draw 1 ampere. Whatever it is, the flux that is set up only depends upon, primarily upon what? The voltage applied. I derived this relationship here. Is it not Vm by omega n is gives you phi m? So therefore, if the primary voltage we applied is has max of Vm1, then omega n1 will give you the phi m. So therefore, once the phi m is set by the applied voltage, then the hysteresis loop is correspondingly set. Once the hysteresis loop is set, the loss is gets fixed. Then the hysteresis loop gets fixed, then the loss gets fixed. So it doesn't depend upon this resistance, but it only depends upon this applied voltage. And higher the V applied voltage here, the Vm sine of cos of omega t. So higher is this Vm cos of Vm1 cos of omega t, higher will be the phi m, and so higher will be the loss, which means that but the loss in this loss, if I have a voltage and connect a resistance here, the loss can be written as Vm square by R, which means that higher is the voltage, higher is the loss. If I want to model that concept and keep it independent of this RLC value, then best is to connect it in parallel with LM, not in series with LM, but better to connect it in parallel with, not in series with this circuit, but rather show it as a shunt element RM. So we usually show it in parallel with LM, we show the RM. Now this is approximation. This equivalent circuit is not the physics, but you could say an engineering approximation of the problem. And for example, the hysteresis loss is not losses are I had given you the factor of 1.5 to 2.5 b to b max to the power n, where n is from 1.5 to 2.5, but here it is shown to be proportion v square by r, which means the factor is going to be taken as 2. So, but the voltages are very, very standard. You know, when you say if 220 volt supply is there, it cannot be more than plus minus 5% on the either side. So then this constant approximation of Rm does not create any problem. Secondly, these drops are small drops. In this leakage inductance by design, they are kept low values. And similarly, this R1 and R2 are also small values. When we do some numbers and some examples later on, we will see this in more detail. But at this point of time, what I'm just trying to tell you is that this may not be more than 10% or 5 to 10%. May not this voltage drop which will happen in these elements will not be more than 5 to 10% of the actual voltage which has been applied. So only though it is that 5 to 10% is important. You know, if I give you 100 rupees or whether I give you 90 rupees, you would clearly see the distinction of that 10 rupees and ask it back, because in 10 rupees you can get a cup of tea. So that's very, very important. But still, it's on the scale of 100, it is only 10% or so. So similarly, this may be around 5% drop. So these are small values. These are large values because, as I said, no load current is only 1 to 2%. So if the given voltage creates very small current with current, then obviously the impedance has to be the large. So these Rm and Lm values are larger. These notions will get more clear to you as we further go deep into the course. But I think I am going to stop here by sort of saying that this is my okay. I'll just do one more thing and then stop. So this becomes my first reasonably detailed equivalent circuit of the transformer. Next, what I will do is I'll simplify this equivalent circuit a bit further. What I am trying to tell you here now is, next thing that I will do is, I'll say that many times I can ignore, when I'm not so much worried about the magnetizing current, I can ignore the losses and the magnetizing current component and simplify this equivalent circuit to this particular form. What is the next level simplification of the equivalent circuit? Ideal transformer. So sometimes you may be asked to work with this level of sophistication, sometimes this level of sophistication is enough, and sometimes just a idealized transformer representation also is enough. It just depends upon the how big is your problem and how important are these details while modeling the transformer. This we will learn the importance of such things only when we do more problems on it. Let's take a break here. Let's stop here for today. Thank you.